All right, our next speaker is Professor Eva Harris, who's from here at UC Berkeley in the School of Public Health. And she's going to be talking about viral and immunological determinants of dengue virus fitness and disease severity.
Okay, isn't this fun? The glow of viruses at UC Berkeley and beyond. Okay, so I'm going to tell you about dengue, and I'm going to choose one of the projects in our lab, and I'm going to do a minimal introduction because I'm going to throw at you numerous concepts in a short period of time and all of the fun complexity that accompanies looking in real populations. Since we moved out of the lab into our collaboration sites in Nicaragua, and we're trying to make sense of pull apart the viral and immunological determinants of disease. So what I'm going to give you just a brief introduction to dengue. It's an RNA virus which is transmitted by mosquitoes, two species in particular called Aedes aegypti and Aedes albopictus, which are highly adapted to human habitat. So this has become a really huge problem over the last, especially about 3 or 4 decades, as it has expanded from classic dengue fever into what's called dengue hemorrhagic fever and shock syndrome, DHFDSS, and there's a new definition of severe dengue that the WHO is using currently. But the big problem with dengue is that there's a huge burden, about 50 million cases a year, and then this really scary syndrome of essentially plasma leakage, which can happen very quickly in about 24 to 48 hours, can kill you, often kill children. And it's really unknown why this happens other than it's an immunological pathology, an immunopathogenesis, as we call it. And so there's a couple concepts that make this disease kind of unique, and that is that there's 4 related serotypes, which actually they have different flavors, all of them, but they actually can all cause the same form of disease. And one of the biggest risk factors for the severe form of the disease is a second infection with a different serotype. So the first serotype will give you immunity for life, supposedly. At least that's the current dogma. But if you get a second infection with a different serotype, then you're at much higher risk for the severe disease. So that usually when you see these kind of pyramids, of course, you have the most severe disease on top. And you know those there's the dengue fever and then unreported dengue fever that we've shown in our studies in Nicaragua that there's at least 20-fold more dengue that actually goes on than is actually reported to health systems. And then at the bottom, of course, you have asymptomatic infections. And usually this is a good thing because you'd say, well, I got through the disease, I didn't even know it, and now I'm immune. The problem with dengue is that what that does is it means that all of these people are now actually at higher risk for the severe disease. So you're actually creating a really huge population problem as you go along. So just to tell you what this disease is, dengue fever is an acute onset febrile illness. It's called la quebradora or breakbone fever due to the bone, very severe bone and muscle pain. Then there's warning signs. Especially falling platelets, increasing hematocrit, abdominal pain, and the severe dengue is very much associated with increased fluid leakage, low platelet count, bleeding, and then this shock from what's called hypotensive shock, hypovolemic shock from low blood volume. And so the reason that we're concerned about dengue these days is that really for 3 reasons. One is the number of cases rapidly rising, a very aggressive geographical spread, especially in Southeast Asia and in Latin America, and the co-circulation, the increasing co-circulation of the 4 serotypes. So to give you just an idea, this is looking over decades, really years along the x-axis and millions of cases in the y-axis, and you can see that there's kind of a cyclic nature, but it goes greater and greater and greater every year, and we're pretty much off the map now. The other problem, as I mentioned, aside from the geographic spread, is that there's these 4 flavors of the virus, and as I mentioned, the co-circulation of the 4 of them is what's associated with these epidemics of severe disease. And so in the 1970s, for instance, there wasn't that much dengue around, and mostly there wasn't that much co-circulation of the different serotypes. And now, essentially, dengue, all 4 are everywhere at once. And so this is a big problem. So there are a lot of factors. Of course, there are a lot of factors that are involved in disease, as we heard from Jay. But in this case, we have not just the human and the virus, but we also have the mosquito. And then the fact that we have these four different virus strains leads to individual risk factors, but then also what we call epidemiological risk factors, which have to do with the population level of immunity to the different serotypes. And in fact, there it's not only one or the other serotype in a row, but which serotype is followed by which serotype can make a difference. And within each serotype, there are genotypes and clades, and that can also make a difference. So it's a mess. And essentially, when this red dot here is kind of the perfect storm, which is when you get the severe disease. And what we've been trying to do in my lab is to kind of pull apart the human and the virus and the mosquito and these different viral and immunological factors. And so what we do is we have a section of the lab that works on molecular virology. Then there's a section that works on pathogenesis and immunology using a mouse model that we've developed, which is also allowing us to try and understand antivirals and actually come up with potential cures. And then we have a 25-year collaboration with Nicaragua. I've been working for those many years, where we have hospital-based studies, a long-term pediatric cohort study based in the community, and then a random controlled trial actually right now for in the here and now, actually trying to stop the transmission. And then additional work through our nonprofit organization called Sustainable Sciences Institute, which has been devoted all these years to try and create scientific capacity in developing countries. So what I'm going to tell you about today really is the viral fitness and evolution and how it links back and forth between the lab and the field, and that's kind of the theme of the work that I've been about all these years, is to create a system where we can generate questions in the lab that we can then answer in observational studies in the field, and then at the same time observe from our field studies, have developed questions, and then ask in the lab how we can answer those. So the question with viral evolution is, one, how does dengue evolve? One of the questions that Molly, who's a postdoc here sitting in the audience, came to the lab with was whether we have changes in when you will see that there's a lot of evolution. Is that just stochastic, meaning does it just evolve and then randomly be one clade will replace another, or is there some kind of a fitness advantage with the clades that survive each other? So, and is it due to replication if it's a fitness question, or is it due to some kind of evasion or enhancement by the pre-existing immunity in the population? So you could have something which is inherently viral or a fitness advantage that has to do with the immunity. And then the other question was whether there was an association of fitness with severity of disease. So that's actually two separable concepts, fitness in a population and the disease severity, and we are trying to get at that question. And so, again, back to the same disease pyramid, what is it that's behind the severe disease? Is there pre-existing immunity? Is it viral genetics? And that's what I'm going to try and talk about today. And then just one more way of expressing this. Again, we have our four serotypes here, and the thought is that when we are infected with one, it's called a primary infection, and oftentimes that's asymptomatic or what we call classic dengue fever. The B and T cell response is developed to that, and then afterwards the person is going to be immune supposedly to dengue 1 and therefore has pink antibodies and pink B and T cells. However, you know, when it gets infected with dengue 1, it can clear the person can clear that virus and not be sick. However, when they get infected with a different strain, say dengue 2, there's this aberrant reaction where it actually leads to higher viral replication of that second infection for a number of reasons. Both has to do with antibody-dependent enhancement, which is an antibody-derived mechanism, as well as inappropriate T-cell responses, which in both cases, the immune response is better at the previous virus than at the current virus. And so you end up with an enhanced immune response to the wrong virus. And that essentially leads to this immunopathology. And that's when we get, again, this, and this is called original antigenic sin. So what you're looking at here are phylogenetic trees of the four different serotypes, and you can see there's a lot of movement going on. And what you see is just this kind of gradual replacement of one clade into another in all of these serotypes. So when they're big enough, they're called genotypes, and when they're little, you can see that each genotype is composed of clades, and the question is, why is there this constant turnover? Again, is it a viral question, or does it have to do with the population immunity? And is there a link with severity? So there's two In all of the history of dengue investigation, there's really only two examples where it looks like there has been a change in the virus which might have been associated with an increase in dengue severity. One in dengue 2 in the Americas, where the American genotype was replaced with a Southeast Asian, presumably more virulent genotype, and that might have led to an increase in hemorrhagic fever. And also a sub-genotype or a clade replacement in Sri Lanka that might be associated with this as well, though it's been very difficult to actually prove this because there's a lot of differences between these viruses. So our hypotheses were whether there's a clade replacement events reflect changes in viral fitness. Is increased viral fitness leading to the increased risk of severe disease? And is pre-existing immunity a major determinant of dengue virulence? And what we're going to see today is that yes, we do see that viral fitness is involved in the clade replacements. In fact, in our case, no, the fitness was not related to the disease severity. And yes, it turns out that the pre-existing immunity is a major determinant. I'm giving this out in advance because it's pretty complex. And so you can be kind of thinking about this in the back of your mind as we walk through this. And so and what I'm going to do is tell you about two studies in Nicaragua and how we use those two different studies to be able to address these questions both in the laboratory and in the field. And so the hospital study, we have children who come to the National Reference Pediatric Hospital, and they are sampled 3 days during their illness at least, a convalescent sample, and then we follow them over 18 months. Now this is because we're looking at a number of other immunological questions, but this allows us to look at disease severity because they're coming to a hospital, large percentages of them are actually dengue positive and severe, so maybe 25 to generally 40% or so will have severe disease. This just refers to, we have blood samples that we then look at the virus, the antibody, and the immune cells. Now in our pediatric cohort study, this is a very different design. Here, what we've done is we have, this is actually ongoing and it's now in its 7th year, and what we do is we enroll 3,800 children and we follow them over all of these years. So they're healthy, and every year we have a healthy blood sample, and we measure their antibodies to dengue over that year. And so what that shows us is if there's a fourfold or greater increase in specific anti-dengue antibodies, then that child was infected during that year. But that could be an asymptomatic or an inapparent or a symptomatic infection. So what we also do is we follow every single medical episode of these children. We have about 80 to 100,000 consults from this group of children now. And so we know that we're capturing pretty much all the dengue that happens. So that allows us to look at children, who have symptomatic disease, and also we know children who have had inapparent disease over that same time frame with the same virus. And that allows us to look at inapparent versus symptomatic disease, but really importantly, we have this pre-illness sample, which is going to be very important in this story. In other words, we can go in time backwards. If we're interested in this infection, we can actually get a sample from that kid before they were infected. We can't do that with the hospital because they're just coming in at that time. So we can look at, they really complement each other with these different study designs. The other thing that's interesting about Nicaragua is that in, say, in Asia, you have all four serotypes kind of all the time. In Nicaragua, we do have the four serotypes, and these are by the different colors. You can see all four colors, but generally one tends to dominate in each season. So that allows us to do a couple of the studies that I'm gonna show you. And so what I'm gonna talk about now is a time period where, for the most part, it was almost entirely dengue 2 during this whole series of studies. So what we noticed, though, which was really curious over that time frame that I was looking at, is that in both the hospital study and in the cohort study, we saw a big increase in disease severity. So this is the percent of the WHO classified, what we call hemorrhagic fever and shock syndrome. And we see this big increase between 2005 and later years in both studies. So it's very different epidemiological studies. So we don't think it's like the same kind of bias by a particular doctor or something. It's actually really happening in the country. So what changed between this time? So we actually are following a lot of information on all of these children and have very extensive databases with hundreds of variables and a lot of quality control and whatnot. So we can actually look at a number of different variables. And we did a bunch of multivariate analysis, and actually nothing really came out except for the year of the study, which was curious. So at the same time, we were collaborating with the Broad Institute to sequence essentially a consensus sequence, and at the individual level, for those that are interested in intra-host diversity, we're also looking at that. And we sequenced the entire virus and actually can then see whether there was a change in the virus. And lo and behold, there was a change in the virus, because what you can see here, this is the American genotype I mentioned, and then Asian American, and then these are the Nicaraguan strains, which are actually separate from the rest of the Asian American. This was the ancestral Nicaraguan in orange, and then this is what happened in 2005. We call it Nica clade 1, that's a Roman numeral 1, and then 2A and 2B over here. And that happened, as you can see, this is a temporal map, where you can see this is the ancestral orange clade, and then we have the clade 1 in purple shifting very precipitously into the blue. Okay, so it went really quickly from one clade into another. And it just so happened that that was right over where we had this increase in disease severity. And so what I'm going to look at again are the viruses more fit, and is that clade 2 associated with an increase in disease severity? So the first question we're going to look at is the question of viral fitness, which is something that we can look at in the laboratory. And the way we can look at that is, one, looking at human cells, so either human cell lines or primary human dendritic cells derived from PBMCs from the Red Cross, for instance. We can also look at the actual patient viremia. So that's a way of looking at the human levels of viral replication. We can also look in mosquitoes at mosquito cells, which we use a lot in the lab. C636 comes from Aedes albopictus. And we can look at real mosquitoes, which we've been doing and bringing, not to here, but bringing Aedes aegypti from Nicaragua to our collaborating labs in Albany, New York. And so the first thing we did was to isolate a number of viruses. So this, everything you're going to see is looking with primary viruses, and we have at least 7 or 8 that are representative of each of these two different clades, and that's what we're going to use in our experiments. And so they're low passage, and we have a number of clade 1 and clade 2 viruses. And for our replication assays, there's two ways. One is pretty standard, where we just have the two different clades, a number of representatives from each, and we infect cells. And then we look at the plaque-forming units that come out, essentially the infectious virions that come out. We also look at percent infection, but I'm going to show you the plaque data. And then we have a direct competition assay that Molly derived, which is essentially competing these two viruses, clade 1 and clade 2, in the supernatant of the virus, of the cell. And then we look over time at which of the viruses are more successful in coming out, because we know at the molecular level what the genetic changes are between these two clades. And then we can quantitate. You can see here one that's a mixed infection, and we can see which at one particular point how much of one or the other clade there are. And so what we see now in mosquito cells is that overall what you have is plaque-forming units on the y-axis and the different clades on the x-axis. And you can see at different days post-infection that actually, for the most part, the clade 2 viruses seem to be replicating better. This is significant at certain time points. In our direct competition assay, you can also see here that the clade 2s, which are above here, they start out at 50% each, but then by the time it's at day 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, we actually can see that the clade 2 viruses are out-competing the clade 1s in this mosquito cell line. If you actually, there's a different way of looking at this, because this is just showing you one example. We can look at a number of different strains, and this is in each case, the input of clade 1 and 2 is similar, but the clade 2s, this is a proportion of clade 2, the clade 2s are winning out in the end. There's another way that you can look at this, that's a relative fitness index. And with clade 1, you can see it's below 1, and clade 2s are above the line, so it's more fit. We also do this with human cells, and this is a human monocytic cell line. And again, you can see that there's an almost significant increase in the clade 2 viruses. And then we do the competition, and again, you can see the clade 2 is winning. So in vitro, it looks like there's some kind of a replicative advantage associated with these clade 2 viruses. Importantly, a lot of these infections that we were looking at were what we call secondary infections, so they're actually in the context of pre-existing antibody. So we did this same experiment in the context of pre-existing antibody in vitro, so antibody to dengue in our cells. And what you can see here is that, again, the clade 2s the clade 1s, or in this case not compete, but grow better than replicate better in the presence of antibody as well. So it looks like there's, and now we can shift and look at the actual viremia data from our kids, and this is looking at days 3, 4, 5, and 6. So we're not looking at viremia here in terms of whether it's the peak viremia associated with severity, because we actually don't have peak viremia on day 1 because the kids come in late to the hospital. But what we can look at is over time in the later days, do we have, and you can see here clade 2 is significantly higher over time. So it's a little bit more, a log or so more virus in the clade 2s than in the clade 1s. And you can see that it actually lasts longer, so that this might be another fitness advantage for mosquitoes to be able to chupar, to get virus out of the person over a later, longer time frame. Now, the other thing that's interesting is, can we map the changes associated with this? So what we've been interested in doing is creating an infectious clone that actually represents these Nicaraguan strains, and then one by one be able to identify which are the amino acids associated with that replicative advantage. And we have a couple candidates, because NS5 is the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase in dengue. And it just so happens that of those very few mutations that you saw, three of them are in, this is a methyltransferase, and two are actually in the polymerase, one in the groove in which the RNA is supposed to lie, and another in where the polymerase interacts with the helicase, we think. So these are two very interesting mutations that we're collaborating with structural biologists and enzymologists to be able to identify at the molecular level. So in summary, thus far, we have both a clade replacement and an increase in disease severity. And we see that the clade 2 viruses are more fit. We have an increased replication that leads in human cells and mosquito cells in vitro, correlated with the higher and longer viremia in vivo. So now the question is, can the arrival of a more fit virus explain this increase in disease severity? And to remind you again, we had this shift in the clade and this shift in severity. And it turns out, though, when we start, so when, this is a really quick aside, we did all of the full-length virus things that we could, and we got maybe 100 and some out, which was pretty, you know, amazing from directly from the serum and the isolates. And at that point, we did see a direct association, a P of a little bit less than 0.05 of the clade with the severity. But Molly and I actually were bugged by the fact that we actually hadn't been able to sequence all of the viruses. So we thought, well, what if there's some kind of a bias, some kind of selection or selective just bias going on that we're not actually representing everything there? So Molly went back and created a genotyping assay where instead of getting the whole sequence, she could just go after by small PCRs the areas that we knew were different between clade 1 and clade 2. And by that, we were able to recover another 80 or so viruses. And when we had that complete set, then that actually flipped the whole answer, because it turns out that at that point, if you now look at disease severity increasing, it's not just in the clade 2s. You can see that in the clade 1s, even though there's less clade 1s as we go on in time, the clade 1s are actually also have this increase in disease severity. So all of dengue 2 increased in disease severity, and it is not associated with that change in clade, okay? So what's interesting, and I'm going to go a little quick on this part, but what's interesting is it looks like actually the clade 1s might actually be more severe. And we're looking here, for instance, at low platelet count, and you can see that there's actually a significantly lower platelet count with the clade 1 viruses than with the clade 2. And we can actually do this using a number of multivariate analyses that show that the clade 1 versus 2B, and now surprisingly, the clade 1s actually might be more severe. Okay, so we've showed that there's this increased risk in general, and it looks like the clade 2s, even though they're winning in the fitness sense, are actually not the ones that are potentially the most virulent. So now this says, so what is, if it's not the clade story, then what is driving this increase in disease severity? So to do this, you actually really need to pull apart the immune response. And it's, as you can imagine, it's complicated, right? Because you've got four different possibilities for having dengue immunity. And it's really difficult to be able to understand that, even using what we call neutralization assays. But because we have this unique situation where we have many years of the cohort, what we can do is is to take the dengue 2 infections here in 2005, and then we have our dengue 2 infections here in 2007, and we can go prior to that infection to see what the pre-existing immunity was, okay? Because now we need to understand, is there something different about the kids that are getting severe disease compared to the kids that are getting non-severe disease, and can we explain that by their immunity? But we can only do that going back in time with samples from this cohort. And so what you see here is that we had dengue 1 and dengue 3 were the circulating viruses before that. We had a big 1998 epidemic of dengue 3, a big 2003 epidemic of dengue 1, and so that's why we're looking at those serotypes. And so what Molly did is do this plaque reduction, well, it's a type of neutralization assay. And so she's looking here at 2005. So the kids that got dengue in 2005, what was their immunity like? And what you see is that they have some immunity to dengue 1 and very little immunity to dengue 3. So this is looking at neutralization titer. Now, if we look at 2007, These are the dengue fever, so the non-severe cases, because of course there were some non-severe and some severe cases. So we're looking here at the 2007. And again, we see that there's some level of dengue 1 and very little levels of dengue 3. And to our big surprise, the one characteristic that we could find with the 2007 severe cases was high levels of both, which is really, really surprising because the dogma in dengue is that the baddie is your number 2 infection. And what that looks like is this. You will have a single monotypic response to dengue 1 and nothing to dengue 2. So this is clearly different. So this is called essentially a polyvalent response. So these kids are not having their second infection. They're having their third or fourth infection. And so this is showing us that actually a third infection not only can cause severe disease, but it turns out that's like the only risk factor that we can associate with severe disease in this situation. So it's really interesting in terms of the way it's not necessarily the virus causing this, but it's also interesting because it's really bringing up a whole new point in dengue immunology, which can only be determined by this kind of careful going backwards in time in the context of this cohort study. And so what we do is if we then look at the percentage of the kids that are severe and not severe, if you look at the numbers that have double immunity to dengue 1 and dengue 3, you can see that a much higher percentage have this when they're the severe diseases than either the non-severe disease in 2007 or the non-severe disease back in 2005. And so to sum up in my very last slides, our working hypothesis is that we had these mutations in an ancestral clade that resulted in increased fitness, and those are the ones that we started showing you have both an effect in replicative ability in vitro, and now we're kind of walking back to identify the molecular determinants. And then we also have some mutations in clade 1 that may have been associated with some kind of increased virulence. And then the third part of that is this cross-reactive immunity from earlier infections is what is really driving this increased severity. And so we think that it's probably these multiple infections and potentially a waning adaptive immunity to dengue 1 because there is some noise in the literature about interactions between dengue 1 and dengue 2 specifically. And so to finalize all of this, I've already told you about this clade replacement, about the fitness. Both of these are at increased risk, and then we think that the higher levels of dengue 3 antibodies and multiple prior infections are what's increasing the risk for severe disease. So I'm going to thank all of our phenomenal collaborators in Nicaragua, especially Dr. Angel Balmaceda and the Department of Biología at the Ministry of Health, wonderful team at the Centro de Salud, which is the health center where we have the cohort study, the hospital, Hospital La Mascota, our nonprofit, and which is based in Nicaragua as well, and a lot of support from the Ministry of Health, Aubrey here, and Josefina and Simona for all of their help at UC Berkeley and in interacting. Phenomenal work here. I mean, there's a number of people involved, but Molly really was the driver here. It's an incredibly complex project, and she's really done an amazing job. Also, Claire and a number of others who've been involved with this before. I want to just point out that Molly has a poster, as does Nacho and Mahelda, who is visiting us from Nicaragua and has been doing a lot of this work as well. And also Brian from, so these are going to be people you can go and follow up some of these stories with. And thank you very much, and to our children.
We have time for one question. Go ahead.
I have two real ones. Is there any evidence that you can get reinfected with these diverse clades within a serotype?
Like I said, the old dogma says no, but we are re-examining that, and we actually, so one thing is that there are divergent genotypes, and it looks from some recent work from Mike Diamond, who's actually a former postdoc, and some others, Ervinda da Silva at UNC, that you can get, at least from monoclonals that are directed to widely divergent genotypes, that yes, it looks like there you can probably get, at least in vitro, a reinfection. Now that's slowly being tested. Of course, there's major implications for vaccines with that. But you can't do antibodies at that fine level. It's only like monoclonals can potentially, even that's difficult. We're looking at repeat infections going all the way back, and Mahela is looking at everyone along every single year, and we're trying to see, because no one's actually really described in humans what a reinfection looks like, even if it's not associated with disease. but what does the immune response really look like in repeat infections? And so we're trying to look at that as well.
The other question is, a lot of acute viruses cause pain, but it's also cutaneous, but the dengue is so severe. The mechanism of that
It's not entirely clear. There's a number of ideas about what's causing the platelet drop in dengue. The interesting thing about dengue, or what really calls attention, is the very severe. I mean, I wouldn't say less than 100,000 is that dramatic, but less than 50, less than 20, that's when you, 20,000 platelets, that's when you really get worried. But the main thing is the concurrent with the rise in hematocrit, because then what's going on is that you're losing volume out of your blood and your hematocrit's rising and your platelets are dropping. So there's this whole coagulopathy problem as well, which I didn't even go into.